Hello, this is Filmmakers 412 Podcast, and I'm your host, Michael Ray. In today's episode, we talk with PJ Gaynard. PJ is a filmmaker. He's been doing this for over 25 years, and he's a well-known pillar of the filmmaking community. In today's episode, we talk about his love for filmmaking, and he also talks about making it great instead of making it big, which was really interesting to me. And he gives some really unusual advice to new filmmakers. I found today's interview to be very interesting, and I hope you get as much out of it as I did. So here is PJ Gaynard. PJ, thank you very much for coming on the podcast. I really appreciate it.
Oh, thanks for having me.
Tell me the story about how you became interested in filmmaking.
You know, I went to school at Rochester Institute of Technology thinking that I was going to become an industrial engineer. And I had taken special engineering courses in high school. I was actually the president of my VOTEC in high school. I went to Cannon McMillan Senior High in Canonsburg, PA.
I'm in Peters. That's where I live.
Oh, yeah. So my goal was to be an inventor and to use engineering as a way to be an inventor. And when I got to RIT in Rochester, New York, I made it. The first semester, they gave me a full load. And the second semester, they gave me more credits than was okay, and I had to get a special paper signed. And then I had a complete mental breakdown and realized that I didn't like doing calculus that much. I wasn't very good at it, or maybe it was just the 8 a.m. courses or whatever, but it was not working for me like I wanted it to. And part of it was that the engineering system, the way that it was being taught to me, didn't allow me to see the cross connections, which I was so desperate for at the time. But I was dating a girl who was a filmmaker, and I knew one person from Canonsburg who had come to RIT with me, Peniota Burt, and she was in film, and she asked me to volunteer on her movie set. The first time was, I'm not sure which was first. My girlfriend asked me to juggle in her first semester, first project that she shot on a Bolex. She said, I just need you to juggle. And she had one crew member. His name was John Carius.
I hope you already had that talent of juggling, or did you have to learn how to do it?
No, I learned how in high school. I learned how from working at Haas's Steak and Sea House. I was a cook there, and Neil from the meat room could do it with he could do it with potatoes, and so I wanted to learn because of him. But so I juggled, and then my friend Penny asked me to. She knew I had a Lady Godiva wig, and that I had clothing from when I did Rocky Horror. I acted in Rocky Horror Picture Show.
Which character?
I played them all. I've played all the characters except Riff Raff. For some odd reason, I've never played Riff Raff, but I've played all the characters many times. So. So I acted in her first project at RIT. She was a transfer from Point Park. So she had come up, I think it was her junior year. And so I wore the bustier and the Lady Godiva wig in the middle of the woods for some short film that she was involved in. And I really liked filmmaking. I liked acting, but I liked working on the crew too. The second time Penny came to me, I said, do you need me to wear the Lady Godiva wig? She said, no, we don't need any actors this time, unfortunately. We don't have a role for you. But if you'd like to come and help out on the crew, we could use a hand. And I was completely willing to help out. And I liked the invention that happens on set again and again. It happens from the creative aspect. It happens technically. It happens in producing. There are problems, and you got to work them out. And I love that. I love the connection points that engineering sometimes didn't show you. It doesn't mean that they're not there. Any engineers who are listening, they know that there are cross connection points. But in filmmaking, if you learn more about editing, you become a better director. If you learn more about directing, you become a better cinematographer. They're all connected. There's no waste in film, and I love that. So for me, it was once I saw that I could be an inventor, and that I could express things that don't have words. That's the power of filmmaking, is that there can be a look, and the Mark Twain always says, you know, words are only painted fire. A look is the fire itself. And I was like, we could get that look. We could have a film full of fires. I loved that. And so I changed my major. It wasn't easy. I was told at the time I could not change my major. I was told that I had to like get paperwork that could not be signed, that they would not give to me. And I got the people to give it to me. I said, no, you have to hand it to me. They said, we're not allowed. I said, you have to hand it to me. I must have it today. I have to do film and I have to do it. And if I can't do it at RIT, I'm going to leave and do it somewhere else. And they made it happen. And so I changed my major at RIT, and I eventually became the president of the student club, of the store, of the school. I did everything I could. Before I left RIT, I had my own office, my own budget line, my own phone number for the school as a student.
Awesome. I just watched some of your videos before you walked in the door here, and I was really impressed with the amount of polish. You know, it's nothing's perfect. You know, there's always things you look at your film, you look back and you say, I'd like to tweak that. But the amount of polish in general was like, it's the best I've seen around here that wasn't professional. I think you've done a great job.
Oh, well, thank you. You know, a lot of, especially the early work is people working for free. You know, I think about Love Sick Love and Rooftop and all the 48 films, you know, that I've made. Those have all been free projects. And basically what I've been able to do, and I think a lot of filmmakers do this, is I go to work on larger films as a crew member. And then I turn the people that I meet on those sets into my friends because I like them. And then once they are my friends, and I'm not lying, I'm not pulling the wool over their eyes, but I do what I can to help them because I care about them. And then I don't mind asking them to help me if they have the time to help me. And so I'm able to get a high caliber of help when they're not working on a larger project.
That's important. So how'd you end up at CCAC?
So, well, just so your viewers or your listeners know, I'm the lead instructor and associate professor and the coordinator for the CCAC Film Technician Program, which is housed at South Campus in West Mifflin. There was an ad, and I answered the ad for a job. That's how I got it. CCAC vets their teachers, especially their full-time instructors. It's a multi-part process. It's not easy to get through that process. But I worked it, and I'm glad I did, because I got to, and I still get to work for an incredible man, George Jaber. And he is my supervisor. He's a former business agent for IOTC 489. He has been at CCAC for 35 years, and he is my mentor, and I really look up to him. And so I'm glad that I worked there. And I worked there because George lets me work there. The thing that he always says to me is that he had a dream, and that there is room for my dream inside of his dream. And I like that, because I think about filmmaking all the time as knowing that no matter what part you're doing, no matter what job you are doing on set, there is room for your creative input if it's given at the right time and the right way. There's room for your creative ideas within that larger dream, and it's going to make it stronger and better. So George and I have tarried forward together to make the film technician program as strong as we can at CCAC.
I think what you just said is true on smaller films, like the whole giving your input and having it accepted. But at the same time, if you were to be on a really big project, a national feature film, that's not really the case, is it?
No, it is the case. It just has to be given appropriately. I've worked on some very large budget films. If you want to give the director advice and you're working as a set lighting technician, I don't know that that's going to work out so well. It's not that they won't listen to you. They just don't have much time. They're very busy, and they're receiving an incredible amount of pressure. But if you're the set lighting technician, you can give the best boy or the gaffer an idea about a lighting piece of that puzzle. That doesn't mean that, and it's not to say that it it must be given at the appropriate time in the appropriate way. But there is room for discussion, you know, sometimes. I do think that there is room.
What about balancing the film work with the teaching? Is that a problem ever?
Oh, sure. when I got hired at CCAC, we had very few students in the film program because I started it. With George, you know, George had a film worker program, and then it has exploded into an 18 or 19 course kind of structure, and we still have more courses that we want. So when we started, we had very few students, so we were talking about maybe working 30 hours a week, and I could easily still pick up a lot of freelance work and additional days. But now it's when we're not in our COVID-19 world, which hopefully by the time your listeners are listening to this, it's not a problem. But normally it's a 65-hour work week on occasion. So it definitely is difficult to balance out. Summers I can have off and I can do what I like. Weekends, of course. But it is a balancing act.
About how many films have you worked on?
I don't know. You know, IMDb has me at over 100, probably, definitely over 100 different productions. I don't think that that recognizes everything, though. IMDb doesn't take into account industrial videos, not wedding videos or sporting events. IMDb doesn't take into account music videos or commercials. And I've certainly worked on all of those different types of productions. So definitely over 100, but certainly a lot more than that.
Do you like to work on a diverse type of video? I mean, something you haven't done before, or do you like to spread it out, or is narrative your favorite?
I like everything. I'm still in love with filmmaking. You know, some people get bitter after a certain period of time, or I've heard industry professionals say, well, like, you know, you won't feel that way after you've been doing this for so long. Wow, this is year 25, and I'm still in love with it completely. And I don't see anything that I'm not interested in. I love directing my own work. I don't see me making a documentary right now, but maybe I just haven't found the right topic to get excited. And then, you know, it's the fire. When the fire gets lit, then it just, you know, it can really drive you in a direction. So this last week, I directed, wrote, produced 3 commercials. I have a web series that I am currently editing a pilot for. I've got a teaser for a feature film. I worked as a camera operator on this Netflix show. They shot a little bit in Pittsburgh, and I got to work as a second camera op on that, called The Trials of Gabriel Hernandez. Last summer, I was rigging best boy on Ma Rainey's Black Bottom, and also best boy for second unit, and there was an insert unit I gaffed for a day. I loved that too. So certainly, I love directing the most. What those projects are, I don't really care. And that's not to say that I don't like DPing, or I don't like working as a best boy or a gaffer or anything else. I like all of those things. I think they're different challenges.
Would you like to be a big director someday?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, I mean, I lived in Los Angeles for 11 years with my wife. We had my son there, and we moved back in 2015. We were there from, you know, 2004 to 2015.
I didn't know that.
And it was great. I was part of the largest lighting union in America, the only lighting-specific union that I know about, IOTC 728. I made spec commercials and real commercials. I directed short films there. I directed industrial videos. I shot a lot of material as a director of photography. I like Los Angeles quite a bit, and I would certainly make a return for the right project. And if given the opportunity to direct something large, I would do it in a second, and probably like almost any of your listeners, I hope.
Do you have a plan to make it big? Like, do you have something you want to implement? Like, if I can just do this and this, then maybe this will happen?
No, I don't have that plan. I think I have a different plan, which is how to make it good. Making it big is a lot of luck. Making it good, that's something I have control over. And if I make every project as good as I can, something good is going to happen. People will see it. Hopefully they identify with it. Hopefully I continue to grow as an artist. And if I continue to grow, each project's going to improve and opportunities will present themselves. People don't want to work with somebody who is desperate for big time, but they do want to work with people who are desperate for good quality. I really believe that.
I think that's the way to go. I mean, I think life in general is sort of like that. You're striving for something all the time, and in the meantime, you kind of miss all the journey in between, and that's where all the like satisfaction actually comes from, I think. So that striving for quality, I think, is the way to go. That's good. You're very articulate.
Oh, well, thank you.
Is directing your favorite hat to wear?
I think it is, yes. I want to be careful to say that I like all the hats, but directing is my favorite because it allows me to be a co-leader in every department. It allows me to be a collaborator in every department. When you're the director, you get it your way. I love that. That's great. Who doesn't? Right?
My wife likes it.
Yeah. But you have to be very careful about how you wield that. I want it to be my way, but I want it to also be our way. I like producing because I like choosing the people that are around me so that I have a hand in saying which hour we're talking about, you know, who is a member of the hour team. But I really love directing because then I get to work with these incredible people. You know, I think about this last thing that I was doing, and I had Danielle Volkar. I don't know if you know Danielle. She is a wardrobe person who really should be in 489 immediately, IATSE 489. She's so talented. She has her own spot in Manessen. She can do all the parts. She shows up with this giant van with you know, out many, many choices for every single actor. She's like completely prepared. She tries everything to do to be prepared. And how can you not love that? But we were doing these commercials, and I'm still learning every project. I'm still growing. I think that I know what I'm doing until I make something. And then I realize, oh, you got a lot to learn. So just so you know, you're 25, still very much learning. But I did not always give Danielle every ounce of articulated description about what I wanted. I thought she knew, but she didn't always knew, and it was my fault. But we would get to set, and I would say, ooh, what if they wore this? And she'd be like, well, I brought 10 options. You did not say that was even remotely on your mind. And so I probably have something like it back in my store in Manessen, but I don't know that I have it here. But we would do it together. We would find the solutions together. And we found incredible solutions together. Would I have found the same solutions with somebody else? Yeah, I don't know. But I'm glad that I found them with her. And that made us, we found the wardrobe solutions together. And did it get to be my way? Yeah, sure. But Danielle got to make her choices too. And it was because of our communication and our work together that we got to do it together. And I love that. I love that. I love doing that with people. And that's what filmmaking is great at. And that's why I love directing. I do have a singular vision. I have a clear vision when I'm directing. And I know what I want. And each day, each moment, as I get closer to directing and through the edit, you know, the film is revealed to me through the process of filmmaking, which I love. But also, I feel like it's revealed to me through that collaborative effort. And so when I'm the set lighting technician, I can only really collaborate with other set lighting technicians, the best boy, the gaffer. And there is an opportunity there to whisper into the gaffer's ear and say, would you consider this? Is this okay? But you can't go to the DP. You can't go to the art director. When you're the director, you can.
Right.
And I love that.
So when you're on a set and you're not the director, do you ever just like see something going wrong and you have to hold your tongue? And does that bug you? Or you just accept it as, oh, this is the way this works?
This has come up many times, actually, you know, because I do different jobs and people find out about it in Pittsburgh. And so I've been hired, you know, in these different jobs. So I've had people in interviews ask me, can you turn that off? Can you come and be my DP and not be the director? Will you end up talking to the actor and trying to give them advice when it's not your job? I like the process, so I'm not afraid to do a part in that process. My job is to do my part, whatever that part is, to the best of my ability. And if I do my part well, then I will free up other people to do their part well. And I believe very, very strongly in the filmmaking process. I use it like my blanket. I wrap it around myself and hold on tight. Sometimes even when I don't know what's going to happen and I just go, I know this process. I know I can trust it. So if it makes sense to whisper something into somebody's ear and give an idea, I'll do it. But I'm careful about it. I try desperately, and I'm a human being, I make mistakes, but I try desperately not to speak out of turn on set and to do my part to be helpful so that I can free up the other people to do their parts and think clearly. Like I said, I'm not perfect. I'm sure I've made mistakes, but that's my goal.
What are your strengths as a filmmaker?
I'm really collaborative. I like to think I'm willing to hear other people's ideas and take them. I work really hard to stay positive. I'm not 100% at it. I still get sad or down occasionally, but I spent a lot of years, when I would get down, going to the bathroom, practicing my breathing, not actually using the restroom, but actually just going to practice my breathing to get calm and come back. I have an incredible amount of energy, more energy than most people, and I know it. So, on hour 16, I still got gas in the tank. I'm ready to go. And I know that. When I was younger, I had to be reminded that not everybody had that. people do want to go home, but that is a strength of mine.
What about weaknesses? What are your weaknesses?
I'm sure I have a lot of them. I can fly by the seat of my pants. Not everybody else can. People like definition. And so even though I will preach it to my students, I don't always do it enough. I have to work at it. When I do it, it's worth it, obviously. So I have to do it. I have trouble getting places on time. I set multiple alarms for myself. I work at it. Everything that I do has got multiple alarms. I have to keep lists. And if I don't, sometimes I'll forget to complete things. So I have to keep lists. I'm sure I have many other errors. I keep looking for them and trying to fix them.
That's all you can do. What are some of the mistakes you see people make?
There are probably several. The first one that comes to mind is not using the assistant camera people well enough on set. I know that seems silly, but I see a number of really, really talented directors of photography in town not allowing their ACs to pull focus. And I really think that is an error, and it's causing additional takes for indie films. I see it again and again. I've seen it on productions that I've been on and other productions, and I would say that that's an error, a lack of qualified script supervisors and a lack of focus on the script supervisory role is, I think, hurting quality in terms of indie films, especially in town. I think that we need more qualified script supervisors, and I think people are forgetting about that position, and it's costing them quality in the end, because in general, I'm making this error too. I want you to know it's not just something that I'm doing perfect. If the actor puts their arm over the other person's arm when they give a hug, three out of the four performances, but they put it under the arm on the other performance, and then the other angle that you shot, they always did it under the arm. It doesn't matter if under the arm is the worst performance. If you're sort of stuck into it, you're stuck into it, And I really believe in Walter Murch and what he says about cutting for emotion first. But sometimes if it's too glaring of an error, you're sort of stuck into this. So I do think that I see not enough focus on script supervisory tasks and not enough focus on AC, letting ACs pull focus. I think that's, super important. And it's really just coming from DPs, especially at the indie level. It's coming from DPs who aren't given enough people on set to have an AC.
What do you think the minimum crew size should be for no to low budget indie?
Oh, it's such a difficult question, because I really think that your crew size and description of jobs within that crew changes based on the nature of the production. If you're talking about like a drama, you're not really desperate for an effects guy on set. If you're making a horror movie, you better you better have that guy, and he better be central and there at the very beginning. You know, if you got a lot of guns, you better have that gun guy right in there at the start, part of every part of pre-production, right? If it's going to be a gun in every scene, you know? If you got no guns, like, maybe that gun guy's not really going to get much use this film. You know, so I think that you have to drive the number, and what job those people do has to be based on a lot of factors. So I think that the key thing to do is to, if you're producing or directing your film, or if you're, is probably break down your script and do a real thorough breakdown so that you understand the key things. I mean, I even think about, you know, from a sound perspective, you know, are we talking about improvisation with multiple people talking over one another at a time? And if we are, maybe one sound person is going the wrong way. Maybe you got to have at least a boom op so that you could potentially swing two booms at the same time, or else you're going to end up in a pickle. Some people might say, oh, 10, 12 people might be the right number. That's not bad. I do think that there's a top out point for indie film when the budget is really low. I think you're forced into having people do multiple jobs because from a budgetary standpoint, even if you said, oh, I'm not paying everybody, it comes to, from a food standpoint. I think once you start paying people, once there's a union, all the rules flip. And what was like, what made sense doesn't make any sense anymore. Like the logic completely flips 180. So I don't know that there's an exact number, but I do think that there's a process at finding that number for you and recognizing that you're going to have to, it's going to be a give and take in terms of quality if you make the wrong choice.
Do you find yourself working with the same team on a regular basis on purpose?
I don't work with the same people all the time, but there are repeat offenders. There are people who I continually invite back. We know that the nature of this business is freelance, and even if it's not fully freelance, even if there are staff, there are people in staff positions, we know that the teams continue to switch. So, you know, does that mean that that I won't invite people back? Absolutely. You know, like there are people that I work with again and again, I like, and there are a lot of them. I like you, Mike. I like Chris Bell. I just worked with Steven Dixon. I really liked him. Getting all three of you on the job together is pretty tough, you know, because maybe we don't need a sound team that big and maybe somebody's booked, but would I call any one of you? Absolutely. Happy with your work. Like spending time with you on set. I think the list is much shorter of people who I've decided that I'm not as excited about with. And I think that that's the way I think about it. I'm excited about certain people, and there's a lot of them actually in Pittsburgh, and they're all incredible. And some of them do the same job and you can't get them all. So I swap the team out sometimes just based on strengths. If somebody's better at doc work and I'm making a documentary, maybe I go to them first. Maybe they're not available. So maybe I end up with somebody who I didn't think of as a documentary guy or a gal. And then I find out, oh, goodness, they're incredible. You know, so glad that it went that way. But yeah, I swap people all the time. But there's a core group, certainly. And it's mostly based on availability and who I haven't seen in a while and who I want to talk to.
Yeah, I can understand that.
And it's usually the fact that, like, I haven't, there are some people that I'm desperate to work with and I just haven't found the way to work with them yet. Like Aaron Moore. I don't know if you know Aaron. He's great. They call him Thor. The guy is really talented. He's a talented director and cinematographer. He's a talented actor. I know that seems, you know, to be able to do all three of those things, but this guy really does it. He just directed a movie that Dean Cain acted in, and they shot in Pennsylvania, and I want to work with Aaron. We've traded messages a dozen times. We've seen each other at events. It just hasn't happened yet. So it's one phone call away.
Are you pretty happy with the quality of the crew around here?
Yeah. I've worked with a lot of great people. I think that there could be more depth. You know, there could be more options. It's not that they're not great. I just need more options, more people that I haven't met yet. I don't think we have enough production designers at the indie level, especially, or maybe I just haven't met them yet. You know, maybe they're out there and I just don't know them.
that's kind of why I'm hoping this podcast takes off. So maybe they'll discover you needing that and they'll contact you, and maybe the community can be a little more closer together after this.
Yeah, I think you're right. And I also think that people are moving all the time. This is it's a many armed beast, the filmmaking community in Pittsburgh. And so we're seeing people who maybe are indie today, you know, and they just don't have any union affiliation, or they're not having those options to be a staff person. Tomorrow they get that job and things change for them. And then all of a sudden, you know, they're not as available, but they're being exposed to things that they just never had a chance to do before, you know, and then you can get them back afterwards.
Better trained?
Well, and more
experienced.
More experienced. I think we're every day we hope that we get another job and that it will provide a level of experience that we haven't had before, right? I hope for that.
Sure. What would be your dream job, dream project?
Yeah, I don't know. I was pretty happy last week directing those commercials. If I was directing commercials for the rest of my life, I'd be just fine.
Would you? Would you get bored at that? I mean, one of the nice things is the variety, I think.
Yeah, I like variety too. So, I mean, the straight fact is that I wouldn't be able to do just one thing only because something else would come up. But, you know, I'd love to direct features. I think that features are a tough market right now. It's really difficult to make money making feature films. I think TV shows are really exciting. I don't know many people who are watching indie TV shows. Web series is, I don't know anybody who's watching web series. I know people who are making them. I don't know anybody who's watching them.
I feel the same way.
So, you know, I know people who are making commercials, and those commercials are getting watched. You know,
that's right.
So
they're getting paid for it too.
They're getting paid for it too. Yeah. So I don't know. I mean, I certainly like all that stuff. I do like everything, but you know, right now I would not mind living that life. Certainly, a TV show directing or show running a TV show would be great. Directing a feature film would be great, just because you could go into a world for an extended period of time, and really just live it and breathe it. And you could do that for a decent length feature, but you could do that for a TV show even further.
Do you do much writing?
Yeah, I do some writing. These commercials that I made last week, I wrote those. I wrote them with the client. I wrote two of them, and then the client revised. The client wrote one, and I revised. I co-write a lot or make adjustments to things a lot. So I have a feature length script that I wrote with Jerry Pietrella, where Jerry wanted to be an angel. He said, that was Cherry's edict. He came to me and he said, PJ, I want to write a movie with you. I want to be the angel. I want to be an angel in the film. And I said, okay, Jerry, we'll find a way. And we did. We found a really cool script. We wrote a feature. We're doing revisions very slowly, but we have done a bunch of revisions. I think it could be more of an animated film, only because it involves like people in Lincolns, in black Lincolns, blowing a hole in the fabric of reality and then driving up into a stadium and then like grabbing people who are having a bowling event in an outdoor stadium and ripping them and sending them to hell.
So what were you guys smoking when you were writing this?
We wrote almost the whole film at Big Dog Coffee. So if you get a chance, go check out Big Dog Coffee. They got very good lattes and honey lattes. So.
Oh, are you looking for some co-op money here?
No, but we wrote almost the whole script there. And so I do some writing, but a lot of it is co-writing where I write with other folks. I'm not afraid to write my own stuff. It's just getting me to sit down and have the time, because along with everything I do in film, you know, between teaching and then making my own stuff, working on other people's stuff, I'm a dad. You know, when I go home, I read my son to bed almost every night. I've read out loud every Harry Potter book, the main books. I've read all the books out loud to him. We just finished a couple weeks ago. We finished The Deathly Hallows, and we watched all the films, and now we're on to C.S. Lewis's Lion, Witch, and Wardrobe series.
That's great. What about the level of acting talent in town? Are you happy with that?
I've met some incredible actors. I feel like there is some union talent that's incredible, and some of them are willing to work on non-union free projects, even though they shouldn't, because SAG will tell them not to do it, and it could cause them a problem in their paid work. But they're still willing to do it. I've still met them, or they've been willing to even like help you figure out the SAG paperwork. So I think there's some incredible people at that level. There are some incredible up-and-comers who are great. So I do think that there is good talent in town, and that the hardest part is getting people who come in from out of town to give them a good look. It does happen. You know, there was some people in this last year, I think there was a TV show that came into town, and I know Amy Lynn got some speaking roles. You know, Kerry Collins has had some good luck. Of course, there's some old hands who have been around for a while and have had very good luck at getting speaking roles. But some people have, to get the speaking roles here in town, they've had to go to New York City to audition and then come back here for the roles. It's silly. And it's not to say that places like the talent group doesn't care. They do care. Nancy Mosser, I know she wants to be casting. She wants to be the main casting agent on things that come to Pittsburgh that are major motion pictures. And she's doing everything she can to give Pittsburgh talent the opportunity that she can when she's involved. You know, there are a lot of good people who want that. It's just sort of making it happen sometimes. It's convincing from people who come in from out of town. And the thing is that what we're talking about right now is we're talking about mostly, what I'm talking about is feature work, right? There's industrial work. The industrial work that I know about that's happening regularly, Dick's Sporting Goods is casting people. American Eagle has been known to cast many local talent for their industrial type pieces, and a lot of young talent has gotten paid work from American Eagle. I'm sure you're aware.
Oh yeah.
And some of it has been still work that has spilled over into the video work that they are showing their employees. So there is some opportunities. I know some people have gotten paid acting work doing Cornerstone, which is religious sort of based work, but it's work, it's paid work.
Right.
Acting, and if you are religious, you know, more power to you. You can tie your religion to acting opportunities. I love that. You know, it's good for you.
Let's say you have some time open up. How do you go about deciding on your next project?
I haven't been bored since 1994. It's not that there isn't time. The way I try to prioritize things is mostly based on excitement. What am I most excited to do? You know, what do I want to spend my time doing? And then I push towards that. If there's a financial gain at the end of it, oh, that's even better. And it's not even the financial gain for me. It's, hey, if we can do what we love and I can pay my friends, that is a good thing. I love that. I won't lie to you. That is the one, that's the best part about producing. When you're the producer, you know that you are going to hire some of your friends and that they are going to walk away with money in their pocket. And that feels incredible. Like there is nothing like knowing like, hey, today I helped all these people provide for their families and pay their rent. Oh man, that gives me goosebumps just thinking about it. That's a good day. And I know you've gotten a chance to feel that, you know, before. I have too, and I love that. So that sometimes is part of the factor. As if there's a financial gain at the end of it, and I can do that. I love that.
Everybody loves money.
They love money, but, you know,
helping the community.
Yeah, yeah. You know, if you get paid, that's great. If you get 20 of your friends paid, that's better.
What do you like best about filmmaking? Like, if you could just pick the one thing.
Collaborative art. It's a collaborative art.
It's satisfying to you?
Yeah, I like doing it. I like doing it with others.
What about the worst thing? What's the worst thing about this industry?
I want to say it's the hours. It might be the hours. And it's not the hours themselves that I mind, because I'm spending the time with people that I love, that I really care about, or that I'm learning to love. You know, I say that all the time, learning to love. It's being forced to choose between this creative, wonderful moment and being with my family. And that I don't like that. So I guess I want the thing that I can't have, which is unending supply of time and a being able to split my body into and be home with my family and then be still making film, that I dislike that choice.
What's your biggest screw up on set ever? There must be some. You've been doing this for so many years. Just give us some comic relief so you're not so perfect in everybody's mind.
I have made some incredible screw-ups. I've certainly learned the hard way that you should not talk bad on people. You can be excited about other people, but, and I'm still working on that, right? Because I want to be honest, but I don't want to, but honesty has its price. I don't want to be the type of person who says somebody's great when they're not great, you know, don't want to lie, don't want to be two-faced. But, you know, you also can get excited about people you're just excited about. And if you're not excited about somebody, maybe you just don't include them in the conversation. So I've made that mistake, and I paid the price. I've lost friends over it. But in terms of comedy relief, many years ago, not that, well, I guess it's been many years now, back in the ripe old year of 2000, I had a job working at Screenlight and Grip in Boston, Massachusetts. Screenlight and Grip provides, and I don't know if they still do it. I haven't talked to the owner, Guy Holt, in quite a while, but he was a mentor of mine. Guy Holt he actually writes part of the Set Lighting Technician Handbook, the Harry C. Box book, which is sort of like I would think of as a important tool in if you're just learning how to do set lighting work. But I had a job working for him. I was Guy's guy. So I worked in the shop, you know, putting lights on shelves and reconditioning lights and putting them on the truck. And that was in the summer. He would send me out on jobs. And of course, in Boston, which is very similar to Pittsburgh, when it gets really cold out, there's limited work. Just like here, there's some work, but it's limited. So in the winter, Guy would, he would hold on to me. You know, he would teach me how to do things, and I would make cam lock cables by hand. Design distro boxes, even ones like Mike has in his studio, where they're sort of like construction boxes. You know, we would do all kinds of crazy things in the winter, and he would still pay me. But he got me this job working for the PAX network, where I would need to deliver a grip truck with a generator on the back of it. So this is a 20-foot box truck with a generator attached to the back of it, a tow generator, probably like a 500-amp tow generator or something. And I had never driven a generator anywhere except in the lot where Guy's place was. And so they called and they said, can we have a grip driver come and deliver this? And they may need to work as the gaffer, actually. So do you have somebody who could do that? And I looked at Guy and he said, well, you could give it a shot. I think you could do it. So I said, yeah, I got it. I can do it. And I had gaffed indie stuff, but I hadn't done anything that big. You know, PAX was a channel on TV. I don't know if it still is. So I said, I can do it. It was some like animal show. And I said, as long as you don't need the driver to like back down a crazy hill in the woods, a mile or something, we can get you the generator up there and get you what you need. But in fact, that's exactly what they asked me to do. They asked me to do crazy stuff. I had to drive the vehicle through the woods, up this hill. And then we realized that the hill was so steep and it was all like muddy that this vehicle would not go up the hill, but we were halfway up the hill. And so it started backing down the hill, even though my foot was on the brake and the hillside was right there. And the generator started going over the hillside. And I thought I was going to die. Like, I just thought like, oh my goodness. And I had my foot on the brake and I like every ounce of adrenaline was pumping. And I'm like, not only can I not get out of this vehicle, I don't think that I can move. Because I think that if I do, even if I put the parking brake on, I think it's going to back up and I'm going over the hillside. Because if this generator goes over the hillside, I think it's going to bring the truck with it, you know, because the generator is pretty darn heavy. And I thought, what am I going to do? But eventually they brought some planks down and we were able to drive the vehicle up a little bit. And then once the vehicle was driven up a little bit, I think I was able to get it up to the top of the hill. And I remember at one point, I think I had it at the top of the hill and they wanted me to back it all the way back down. And I was like, I can't do that. But the area was too small to turn around with the truck. And so eventually they realized they had somebody who was who used to be a tow truck driver there. And they said, don't worry. We're just going to just get it up to the top. So we got it back up to the top, and then they were able to let the tow truck driver turn it around, like he, without jackknifing it. So it was, that was a crazy night, and I was...
scary stuff.
Oh, man, I was so scared. So that was really rough. That was a mistake. One night, I didn't have any rain gear. It was 40 degrees outside. That was pretty rough. I went out and bought $120 rain gear after that. I think everybody gets caught once in the rain before they go buy that expensive rain gear.
What advice would you give someone just wanting to break into film?
Do it. If you want to be there, be there. You know, make the room in your schedule and be there. And when you get there, and even if it's a free project, even if it's nobody famous, even if it's the smallest thing, do it. And then when you get there, stay busy. Ask people if you can help them. Stay attentive. It's so difficult to stay attentive sometimes because it seems like nothing's going on, but of course everything's going on. You know, because film is the most exciting paint drying that you've ever seen. You know, it's all happening sort of in slow motion and yet super fast at the same time. And it's very easy to get distracted by your phone or just sort of like for your brain not to be there. So be there, be present, be part of the solution and listen and watch people's eyes. Watch where they look. It's so huge. You know, just if you watch, you can see what they need before they say anything. And then help them. And if you got nothing else to do, just go get somebody a water. It really, really will help them.
You know what? That's some great advice because I work with freelance assistants all the time, and there are some really bad ones. There are some really bad PAs. But a good one is worth their weight in gold. I mean, I told you I worked with Emily. Like, she assisted me on a photo shoot. I met her on your shoot, and then I just brought her, you know, I just hired her for a day of helping me, and she was excellent. She's one of those people that, like, you know, you turn around and say, can you, and she's already doing it kind of thing. So,
right. It's being attentive, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, I can teach you the name of something, you know, a C stand or a duck bill or a, you know, quacker clamp, you know, I can teach you what a walkie talkie is, but you have to want to be attentive. That's a hard day, but you can do it. You can do it. So if you want to be there, be there.
Okay, so what kind of advice would you give the indie film community to make themselves better? So you've probably seen a lot of mistakes over and over again. If you want to be an indie film guy in town, what are some suggestions you'd give?
Oh, you're going to hate this. You're going to hate this because I know the exact thing that every indie film person needs to do in town. They need to join a union. They need to not be indie only. The trick is you have to realize that there is a large system at play and that when you are part of that system, then you're able to have more freedom than you know about. So as a prime example, I think about myself as an indie filmmaker. I make projects happen, bootstraps, but I also work I'm a member of two unions. I'm a member of IATSE 489 and I'm a member of IBEW 5. And it's the money that I make there that I'm able to then turn around and use in my own productions. It's the contacts that I make there that if I'm careful and I know when those people aren't working, I can then draw them into my smaller productions and use even one of them as the carrot to then drive lots of other indie people onto set with me, because they want to meet or get to know those people. When you're part of a union, you work with the best people in the world. When the ASC, most union, you know, local 600 DP comes to town, he's gonna be working on that union project. And if I'm lucky, I'm gonna be working with him or her. And then I'm gonna take that knowledge that I glean from them and I'm gonna bring it back to my indie project. So, it's absolutely understanding that when you work together, there's that symbiosis between indie and union. That is the key. That is the key. Because right now in Pittsburgh, there are some super wonderful people at the very bottom of the rung who are making stuff by their by whatever hook and crook it takes. And there are some wonderful people who are union level people that make a living working on the largest productions in town. And there is not enough in the middle. And the reason why there's not enough in the middle is because there is not enough people at the bottom getting an opportunity in the union. And there is not enough time when there's downtime for the union people to come down and help out. And it really, it's that cross collaboration. And I see, when I see it work out, when I'm on set on 489 jobs, and I look around and I say, that person is part of my team and we made a 48 together. And that person is part of my team and we made a 48 together. And when I see that number get to 10 or 15, and I have recently, last summer I worked on Ma Rainey's Black Bottom, and several people on set were people that I had seen making their own movies, and now they're working on this larger budget production, and they're definitely going to take the things they learn, and when they go make another 48 or they get an opportunity to bounce up, you know, so maybe they're working as somebody in the art department, and then they get a chance to be a production designer on an indie project, that's going to help them be better in the art department the next time 49 calls. It's also going to, but that goes back both ways, you know. You know, Ma Rainey's had an incredible first AD, this lady Shelley. You know, she was unflappable. Great. Well, I think about, you know, there was Michael Good was PAing for her. He was like a really good set PA. Well, you better believe he learned from her, and the second AD, he learned from them. So if I ask him the first AD my project, he's going to be that much better.
Right.
So I think that that, doing that, playing that game back and forth, that's the thing that is going to make us stronger in Pittsburgh across the board. And so, you know, that's what I try to do all the time is there a way for me to grab those carrots and then see them swapping back and forth? I don't know if that's the answer that anybody wants to hear, but the indie community can make the union community strong, because the stronger the indie community is, the more, the better the permits are that get into 489 and get in. And then from the event world, that's IBW5 for utilities. That's going to make the utilities stronger. And then at the same time, if you can get one of those people on your indie project, even for a day, it's going to make your project so much stronger.
I think a lot of people are going to be disappointed in your answer, just because they're the weekend warrior types where they have a 9-to-5 throughout the week, and being on those crews, you know, being in the union doesn't really apply to them.
Maybe so. But I don't think that that means that they can't still access those people for their project.
Oh, sure.
And so the key is how do they help create that? I hear what you're saying. And those people who we might call weekend warriors, you know, I do think that they are still quality filmmakers, very quality filmmakers. They just have, for whatever reason, have got to do something else during the week. And there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, the trick for me is that I know that when things are working in town, when the tax credit is strong, when there is a balanced budget from at the state level that's working for us, that I know that the rental houses in town are then hopefully working. And even if they're not the primary tool that is being used on a large production, maybe they're a secondary tool or they're getting some rentals. When there are a lot of rentals going out at those rental houses, the indie guy can't maybe access them. But if there's enough work happening at those rental houses, then during the down period, they will have enough money in the bank that they can offer the indie person a real deal or a real opportunity to borrow that gear at a fraction of the cost. But if there's not enough union work, if there's not enough high-level work, and it doesn't have to be union work. I mean, Steeler Games is union work, but Giant Eagle commercials, not always union work. But I would think about that as high-dollar work, right?
For sure.
But if there's enough of that, that's going to keep the rental companies busy enough and keep enough gear here that when it sits on the shelf for a couple weeks and they know they don't have anything going out, they can offer that opportunity to an indie filmmaker because it's here and it's sitting. But if it sits for too long and there's not enough higher-end work, then it's not going to be here.
Right.
So I do think that it's a system.
Well, that's great. What are you working on now? Or what's coming up? What's on cue?
I spoke to Lydia Zagorski yesterday about directing a short for her. Probably a one-day short. I've got edits to complete for these three commercials, of course. Edits for a web series pilot. A little bit of editing for something I shot last year, just so that it can be available publicly. So a good bit of editing. Of course, we're in COVID-19 right now, so...
So you can do all the editing you want.
That's about what I can do. Otherwise, I'm not really sure, what is going to be the next move as a director. I was in talks to DP a feature that was going to be like 3 weeks here, a week in India, maybe starting in June, but I'm not sure, I will tell you right now, everything's on hold. Every production, Netflix, completely on hold. My friends in Hollywood, my friends who were working 7 days a week in Hollywood, they were prepping a stage, a grip crew that I knew, and they closed the stage and just said, maybe in May.
Wow. That's so scary.
Yeah.
Is there something you'd like to tell the local filmmaking community? Just, is there anything else you want to say?
Don't give up. Don't give up. The work you are doing, the stories that you're telling need to be told. And you are always one step away from an incredible opportunity. And the difference between where you are now and where you want to be, it is one person away that you haven't met yet. It is one movie away that you haven't made yet. It is right there. And there are going to be a lot of people who tell you that you cannot do it, that there is no pathway forward, and they are absolute liars. And I know it because I have friends who are successful, and they keep me going because I hope that I can be as successful as they are. And just know that it is one step away. At the same time as it is one step away, that every brick is a brick in the wall, and that you are going to keep making movies. And somebody asked me, he said, why do you do this? Why do you do this? And I said, because my wild heart demands it. That is why I do it. I don't know any other way than to do it. And if I didn't have to do it, I wouldn't do it, but I have to do it. So I mean, that's why I think you should keep doing it. If you need to do it, do it.
Very inspirational. Thank you. So how can people get a hold of you if they want to reach out?
They can email me, pjgaynard@gmail.com, pj@goatmilkfudgeproductions.com. You can find me on Facebook. I'm on there too much, but I'm on there. You can call me. My phone number is 310-743-2953. I answer the phone. You text me. I accept carrier pigeon.
Well, I really appreciate you taking the time to come down here today. Thank you very much for coming down and not, venturing out. I had a couple of people cancel on me just because of the virus threat, it's understandable, but I think this was a lot of fun. Thanks again.
No problem. Thank you for having me.
Take care. Okay, everybody, thanks for listening. If you found us on our webpage, please leave a comment and let us know what you think. If you found us on iTunes or Spotify and you like the show, please leave a rating or review. And whatever you do, hit the subscribe button.